Okay, we'll call this meeting to order. Start with the pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, approval of agenda. I'd like to add committees and board reports. I'd like to add D, update on the Bartlett Bridge replacement. Anybody have anything else?
I don't know if you want me to put this under public forum. I just wanted to make you aware of nomination papers. Or would you rather have it under committees and boards or? Other, whatever's good.
Yeah, I mean, it really doesn't matter. We can talk about it other.
Other?
Yeah, sure.
That's it? I make a motion to approve the warrant as amended.
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor? Okay, our next item is a public forum. This is where anybody from the public have any comment on any non-agenda items. Now is your time. Any comments from the public? Okay. Approval of the minutes of February 23rd, 2015.
I did see anything, so I make a motion to approve the minutes.
Motion by your second.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, committee and board reports. Planning board meeting Thursday, 3/12. At the Mildred Day Library School here at 7 p.m. There'll be a joint meeting with the Budget Board Wednesday, 3/19 at the Mildred Day Library School. That's the Selectmen and the Budget Board. On March.
That's going to be in the gym too, Dan.
In the gym?
Yeah, we got acceptance today.
Oh, yeah.
We'll square up some tables in the corner. We had a choice of trying to go into the little conference room, but with two boards and people, I mean, you know, a few people here to present.
Yeah.
If that's all right.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay. On March 12th, there will be a manager's search committee meeting. This is with the selectmen and the search committee.
Are you going to be able to get in all right?
Okay.
Yeah. We're going to do it over here, not the town hall, right? Or the town hall, where are we going to do that?
I thought you were going to be up.
So we're going to do it over?
Over here.
Over here.
Oh.
Isn't that what you suggested, Dawn?
Yeah, it's easy.
I'll have to put in a request, okay, so you want it in the conference room?
Yeah.
I got a little letters check on it. Takes a little while to get approval.
Okay, well, if you can.
First thing in the morning, I can email.
I can email everybody and say.
It's
a town hall.
Yep.
Okay. You can get in the town hall.
Yeah.
It's just easier here than going up and down those stairs.
You're right. I'm with you.
Yeah.
And we're posting those, right?
We will post them.
Yeah, okay. The search committee meetings?
I haven't posted them.
No, but I can.
No, it's all an executive session.
Executive session to review resumes.
And then the last item on committee and board reports is the Bartlett Bridge. I attended the meeting on March 5th. Basically, it was just kind of a preliminary meeting. They were asking for input on, you know, what types of closures, one lane, you know, full closure, you know, for a six-month period with detours around, and there was definitely some strong opposition from the Kennebunk folks for detours. I guess they're gonna be doing some work down over in Dock Square or in that general area also. So, you know, they're looking, they're trying to figure out, you know, what they're gonna do, whether they're gonna move it over on one side, do one lane on one side, and do a one lane on the other side. So they're still looking at that stuff. This will be like about a six to eight month project. Right now, they budgeted $2.3 million for the engineering work. They plan on advertising in February of 2016 with, you know, construction in 2016. The only other thing that came out of it is, you know, Barry asked about maybe putting some conduits or something in the bridge in case we ever decide on doing some lighting. There was some discussion, they or Arundel, there was some discussion on maybe making sure that the bridge is wide enough in case, I think Kennebunk is working on that part of Route 1, and they're doing some sidewalks, and they're, you know, with a possibility of maybe putting some sidewalks on that bridge. And then there was also a little bit of a discussion on, in case we ever do sewer, making provisions to get the sewer across. So that's all kind of preliminary stuff. They took down, you know, a bunch of notes, and I'll be setting up another meeting relatively soon here, so. Pretty much all that we got out of it. Roger was there, Terry was there, and Renault was there from my office. That's it for that. Manager's report.
I got just a few things just to keep you up to date. I talked either at the budget meeting or the Selectmen's meeting last time about some questions regarding the sheriff's office billing for the sheriff's office police protection for the year. I have talked to the sheriff about it, and we're reviewing that document. We have identified what the issue is. To make a long story short, in the past, the contracts with municipalities or private, you know, towns were always based on entry-level offices, okay, so base pay because many times they didn't know who the officer was going to be. In some cases, as you know, they hire officers for the contract. In this case, that's what happened to you in the past. This new sheriff came in and corrected the contracts to indicate what the salary line was for the actual officer working under that contract. So it became like the officer's personal union contract salary. I understood that. Apparently other people have called the sheriff, because I wasn't the first. And I said, we need to know that up front. We can't, you know, after the fact isn't gonna work for me. He's gonna review that old practice, and we're gonna get back together and discuss that. Again, my argument is, if there's gonna be a change in the billing practices, you need to let us know at budget time and not, you know, and not after we've budgeted and sent the bill in. I get the feeling it'll probably get resolved. Talked to Todd about it as well. But it isn't resolved exactly, but I did want you to know. The warrants tonight, on the invoices tonight, I agreed to pay half the bill, which is pretty typical anyway. I mean, we know we're gonna pay, you know, and the reason I did that is so that when we can resolve the rest of it, I don't have to make an adjustment or whatever. So the sheriff was fine with that, very cooperative. Said he'd try to work with us on it, and I'll keep you in constant to what we do.
So we budgeted for a certain amount, and now we're getting charged more than that?
$9,000 more than what we budgeted.
Right.
Okay.
Well, we budgeted for that. Yeah, maybe you said it and I didn't pick up on it, but we budgeted that amount based on what they told us.
Correct.
Right.
Do we have signed contracts?
No.
Not with the figures in it.
That needs to be improved, I think.
I mean, I'm certainly for the fire, I mean, the police protection, but you just want to make sure that we know what we're paying for here, you know?
And I, you know, from a management point of view, if I came into a, you know, to a setting and saw that that was happening and, you know, throughout the county in two or three different locations, I would certainly want to correct it, make a recommendation instead of the SO taking, you know, somewhat of a loss. Now, I use that word carefully because the contract is very, very extensive. And there's a lot of line items to that contract. So there's, I gotta say this politely, there's not a lot of sympathy out of my soul for a year of making an adjustment if they have to. So we'll keep working at it, and I think honestly that the contract in the future should have a dollar sign in it that, you know, we can advise it for and be held to. And one of the exercises that I want to go through with him for budget purposes is to do that.
So we'll see that, did we?
I have to say it was a good positive conversation, not no discord whatsoever, but nevertheless, it's a little bit of a kick in the pants.
Well, it's a different administration too, because we started off the whole process with a different sheriff.
On the ambulance purchase, we're moving forward with that. We're bringing different chassis in, different samples in, different demos in. We've looked at one last week. We had it for the day. We have another one coming in next week. So we're moving in that direction, just so that you know. Basically contacting, you know, the ambulance providers in the, you know, in the northeast part of the country and saying, hey, if you got a demo, bring it up, I'd like to look at it.
Okay. So how's the support been from the fire station on that?
Good.
Yeah. And they're okay with not specializing?
I have not heard any negative responses. If a demo, we talked about this, the chief and I and assistant chief, and I think a couple of the guys that were there that day the demo came in. If, you know, and I'll just be silly for a minute, but if there's an ambulance demo that comes in that's, you know, got a price tag on it and it you know, and it doesn't have a light in the back, we could put a light in the back, you know what I mean, and get that charge added to the demo cost. I mean, you could still add a particular to it if you need to. It's not stock built, but it doesn't mean that you have to go without just because it's a demo. If you need a light, you light and something. So we have some flexibility, but I just wanted you to know that we've taken that pathway. Good. And you know, they bring them in. It's, you know, kind of nice to see them hands on, so that's the way we're working on right now.
Yeah. I have a question on that.
Sure.
Who does the repairs on our ambulance that needs repairs? Does the town garage do repairs if the ambulance needs repairs?
Yes.
I'm thinking if you bring in a demo, that you're looking at, seriously looking at a demo, you might want to ask the mechanic about that brand or whatever.
Yeah.
And because you might get, you might find one that's perfect and the mechanic might realize that unit or that brand or whatever has more problems than it's worth.
Exactly, yeah. Particularly in the engine department, the chassis department, not so much in the box. Because, I mean, although box up, the box is a specialty unit, but the chassis, you know, is a definite raw chassis, either a Chevy or Ford or whatever, and you're right. And certain motors have had histories,
right,
as you know.
Yeah.
I don't have to tell you that.
Roger should have some input.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Roger and I have been talking about it. And, but that's a good suggestion, and Valma, but, you know, it's a team effort, hopefully. You know, the firemen can certainly have the input on the specialization of things and what they want. Now, you also understand that we have lots of firemen, lots of people who have lots of opinions.
Yeah.
And if you have lots of people that, you know, that are here on a short-term basis, the opinions are quite readily available.
Yeah.
as I have found out, you know. Pine tree waste, I talked a little bit about recycling, and I've continued to work with them. This is not a crisis that's going to, you know, we have to deal with it head on right this very minute. I wasn't sure about that in the initial conversation. It was like, oh, you know, this is like right in front of me right now. And it isn't, but I've asked Pine Tree to draft up a potential extension contract that we can look at. And they're doing it, and we're working together on it. And basically, the ingredient of that contract, and this is just verbal, would be basically the same with just a temporary escalation clause on recycling. So if recycling does become a cost, you know, we would pay a little towards that. And if it drops off and doesn't, it would de-escalate. So we wouldn't be locked in. It would be sort of a floating number with a ceiling. Okay. Again, we're talking about $6,000 at this point of added cost for that tonnage the way it is. I think the point to remember is right now, recycling is costing people to process. And he's a great guy to work with and very laid back about it. He said, yep, we'll talk about it, we'll look at it, and I'll, you know, hopefully have something that you can look at too, okay? That Dana's contribution land park, I don't know what you call it at this point, but we do have a committee put together. There's a meeting scheduled. We've invited, is it LaFleur? Okay, to be on that committee. Jen's got a group together. I'm going to sit on it, you know, at least for a while. And, we're moving forward with that suggestion that you folks came up with.
Who's on the committee, Jeff?
Tad, Jim, me, Rick, Dana, obviously.
Roger, I think that's Roger.
Roger, because of the impact there. Yeah, he was reluctant, but we talked to him. He said it wasn't an option yet. I think that's the bulk of it, Dan.
Good.
Okay. We haven't met yet, but there's a meeting scheduled, and I'm not sure it's either end of this week or next week. I don't know if you folks have the same sense of humor I do, but probably not, but I don't know if you noticed the budget committee minutes, because Simone said, you're going to take minutes at this budget committee, I should draw. So I gave the minutes the next morning, and it was probably a total of 50 words, you know, opened up the meeting and, you know, did this and reviewed the budgets. And then Jim, and John Bell sent his minutes out, was 36 pages. And I said, wait a minute, how is that same meeting? Well, you know,
fell asleep before I've been.
Apparently,
John captured it well, because Jason was looking for some stuff and I was going to scan a whole bunch of stuff and send it to him.
Oh, took care of it.
But John took care of it.
So I was going to do the same thing. Yeah, right.
Felt good.
I said to Simone, did you see John? They're great, but it made my 50 words, you know, a little shaky.
He's very thorough.
Anyway, that's all I have.
I didn't see him take any notes. That was good.
I know. That, when I saw that, I'm like, geez, I didn't see him writing.
I thought I did an extra job, you know?
With a phone or something?
Must have.
I can do this now, too, if you want. I don't know why I put names on these folders. It was just probably because I had to keep track of how many I did, but they're all the same. I don't want you to think you're getting something special. I'll put that with Jason. I'll pick up his stuff at the end. So,
thank you.
What this is this is the latest and hot off the press information on the RSU 21 construction project. And I'm not going to read this. You can go through it yourself, but just quickly go through the paper so you know what's there. There's a note from Kevin. I've been talking to Dr. Crowley about the project, as you would expect. There's a Dave Friend's letter that kind of introduces the project, it's frequently asked questions, nicely done. There's a total project budget for this construction project. There's RSU building renovation facts, so more or less details of, and then there are four plans, building plans of the projects. One, the reason there are four is there's upper floor and lower floor of the high school, Kennebunk Court and the day school. Then, there's a bunch of papers that, copies of correspondence going back and forth with legislators, and on that special bond work that they're looking at. Tom, you made reference to it, I think, not too long ago. They're looking to get legislative help on the way the bonds are handled. And it's interesting, and I just thought you might like to follow that discussion that they're having on that with the different people. And then the last document is the up-to-date engineering report on this building itself. And it indicates what the problems are with this particular building. And that report is new. It's what's the date on it, Tom? I don't have mine.
January 13th.
Right.
This year.
Within a month, okay, I think, okay. So, I thought it might be of interest to you to have all the latest information. I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but I also made the same package for the budget committee, just thinking that might be useful information for them down the road as well, and I guess knowledge is, you know, part of understanding, and I will give them out, you know, when we have our budget meeting. But Dr. Crowley indicated that he would come and talk about this, we'd go through this, and I said, let me think about it a little bit. I thought, well, if we did that and had him come and go through it, which would be a service, we ought to do it at a budget meeting when we have both groups, you know, and he can have, you know, both the budget committee audience and you as well. I don't know what you need to know, what you want to know.
Well, I haven't been able to attend any of the RSU meetings in a while. Most of them have been the same nights as ours, but have they, you know, if they're talking about doing any type of public meetings to go over? I mean, I know they did this
memo
before.
Says they are.
Yeah, they will.
The email in front, first one.
I think what Kevin has offered, Dr. Crowley's offered, is to personalize a little bit and, you know, and come directly, you know, to talk to you about it. That's a nice service if you need it, if you want. Like I said, maybe at a joint budget meeting or something, you could do that down the road.
Kevin's going to be back here as principal in September.
Yeah.
She's already said that.
Yeah. Good guy to work with. I'm not showing my prejudice. I mean, he's a good communicator and good passing. You know, we worked on this project, you know, last month together or last 3 weeks together. And, anyway, you've got the latest and information on it.
Yeah, the engineers right now, the RSU is spending money that it knows it needs to spend for the engineers to come in here. Probably, maybe not so much now, although with the frost going out of the ground and everything, they may still be doing it to check the ceiling and the beams in the gym and that wing, the library here. Over the course of the winter, I understand they did something in the gym to reinforce those beams.
There's plates up in them.
Yeah, because they found that it was moving more. To keep it safe. So,
comments from the board. Do you think that, you know, we want Kevin to sit down and go over, or wait for the public hearings, or?
Well, why don't we get a sense of the two boards when we're together and then
Okay.
Yeah.
And see what everybody thinks about that.
Yeah, works. Yeah, remind me, and I'll bring it up when we get together the 19th. In the meantime, I thought this might be, good information to have, kicking around. Part of the problem with a lot of these issues like that is if you get bad information, or you don't get, the accurate information, and that's where things start to fester, and, if you can, you have a little resource of your own and say, no, I, this is what that means. That's it, thank you.
Okay. New business. Ambulance billing rates.
Well, Chief was gonna be here tonight, and late this afternoon, his wife became ill, and matter of fact, she's gonna be hospitalized, so he, but I couldn't do this, I think, because he and I went over it in pretty good detail. It's pretty simple, we're recommending that the rates remain the same, all right? And this, I don't have copies enough, I can pass it around, that's the current rates that we have. That's a far cry from what the company recommends, but remember, they're recommending it on a national basis, and the chief feels that our rates are reasonable, our rate of recovery is good, very good, and Brent Nance, we're doing worse, sometimes you raise the rates and they'll get, and we're at the Medicare's gonna pay flat rate anyway, as you know. So the chief's recommendation would have been to you tonight, that he recommends that you maintain the same rates.
Are these rates comparable with the surrounding towns?
Yes, he checked. That's one of the little projects that we did. Some of the bigger organizations have a little bit more, we're on the low end, but we got a great rate. We're over, I think it's 93%, collection rate. Something you can look at.
So, are you looking, you're looking for a motion tonight to accept the rate?
I think we can, I know if he was here, this is what he'd recommend, because we planned on it.
Dick, he's comfortable, these rates are not only fair, but also covering, especially Ken, our expenses.
I use the word carefully, but that's an income source for us.
Yeah, right.
Some people call it a moneymaker, I try to avoid that word.
So, looking for a motion to accept the rates as recommended by the chief?
I make that a motion.
I'll second it.
Motion and a second, any other discussion? All those in favor?
I want to authorize the town manager to sign document on behalf of the...
I make that part of my motion.
Okay, liquor license renewal. Yep, Dutch Elm.
And I have the code enforcement officer's approval and the sheriff's contract that needs approval on that.
Anybody got any questions, comments on that? All right, entertain a motion to accept.
Move we accept the request.
Second.
Motion to accept the license renewal for Dutch Elm Golf Course. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries. Liquor license renewal for Seafood Center.
This came a little bit later, so I haven't seen Troy, and I forgot to catch Jim this afternoon, but I don't believe there's any issues as far as it's for malt and wine. If you want to approve it, and then I'll hold it pending Jim's authorization, but I don't think there's any issues.
Make a motion to approve it pending Jim's and Troy's authorization, or whatever we get from Troy.
I'll second it, Tim.
Okay. Any further discussion on that? All those in favor? Tax acquired property, quick claim, coffee map, 35, what, 22C?
We do have some people here tonight, at least a gentleman.
One.
One. And Simone can explain this better than I, although she has done very well educating me and keeping me up to this, and it's a little quick change in what took place a few weeks ago, so.
It's my understanding that the sale was moving forward, but not quickly enough to avoid the foreclosure process. They wanted to hold the closing, but at the same time, we're a little intimidated about transferring a property that's tax acquired. So he's brought the check in tonight for the full amount, which is the $3,504.72 as of today, from the title company, which would take care of the taxes for all liens and current taxes all the way, which would carry it through June 30th of this year. So it's paying the April portion as well. But they just wanted to make sure that before they finalize the closing and everything, that you would accept the sale back to Jack Coffee for the property so they can get the title work cleared off. I told them it was 99.9% sure. They usually don't like to hang on to property, but I couldn't guarantee.
You're not in the business of real estate.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a good idea.
Yeah.
I make a motion that we sign the quick claim and get this taken care of.
Did we prepare the deed or did the title company?
We did. Did you?
Yeah.
You know, most often I don't see the grantee referenced by last name and then first name.
Oh, okay.
But if the title company's happy with that, I don't care. But usually it's
the other way.
And you don't want to see it indexed with Coffee as your first name.
I'll mention it to him.
Yeah.
He was fine with it, but I'll mention that to him, yeah. Sure.
That's more of an indexing problem at the registry.
Yeah.
I know that.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have a motion. Do I hear a second?
I'm sorry.
We have a motion to accept the quick claim. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries.
It's a good thing.
Thank you.
Everybody wins, right?
It should have never happened, Jack. It was under contract, should have closed in April, personally. Yeah. This is just a quick slant.
Yeah.
The bank, when they refinanced it a few years ago, they put the wrong title, the wrong description for the wrong each house that was next to each other. The Bank of America has taken since April to address the issue and was able to stay. And so Jack Coffee was left not being able to sell his house and pay his tax bill. So.
Someone says able with Bank of America, not bad.
Nothing to say about that.
I've got some occasions.
It's unbelievable.
I don't know, but then it's. Maybe they are, there's nobody to talk to.
You can try.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I contacted four different attorneys, none of them would touch it because it was Bank of America.
Right.
Yes, sir. Okay. Anyway, thank you.
Okay, next item on the new business is review and sign accounts payable warrant.
So move.
Motion.
It should be kicking around somewhere.
Yeah, the warrant's already.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Motion carries.
Things are going very well, with another team effort, as you know, but making good progress and backlogs and issues of getting current.
Just in time.
So we have lots of help and pulling together as a team, which is working out quite well.
Appreciate your effort in getting that moving.
The last packet, just so that you know, got by me because there were a new person preparing them. So I actually didn't see them until after you signed them, which we've corrected. And I did look them over afterwards. So I wanted you to know that, but that didn't matter. first.
Okay.
Working out well.
Excellent.
Is this your new email address, Jack, to have to tell us?
No, yeah, I just use the town manager one.
Okay.
Because the one you're using now actually is a personal one.
Okay.
And you see how I signed that note?
I see.
Yeah.
Seems to be a problem with that process, so.
You want to be politically correct, is that what you're saying?
Right.
Sim, you had something?
Yeah.
I just wanted to let you know that nomination papers will be available March 16th, which is before your next meeting. So I just want to make sure that everybody is aware of that, that they will be available March 16th through April 24th. And they, this year, it would be you, Dan, and Phil that are coming up for reelection if you'd like to take out your nomination papers again. RSU Director is Susan Sinnott-Curran, is her term is up. And Budget Board, the three-year term, there is no one that has filled that position. Paul Raymond is, has 2 years left of his term, so that's one position there. And there's two more positions for 1 year because we keep putting them up as they come up to fill. So if you know anybody that's interested in running for the Budget Board, shoe in, but nobody takes out papers, so that's under other.
Put them on the roadside or anything like that.
And the only other thing, I didn't put it under other, but under other, I came across this, and I hope it's okay with you. I was thinking of maybe asking John Bell to do something up on the website, asking residents for pictures of Arundel, maybe something for our town report book, maybe with his winter pictures or things that are something in the town. So if it's okay with you, I'll ask him to put it on the website and see if anybody wants to, you know, bring forward any pictures or anything like that. And here's your notice for the town report for Dan. So if anybody has any ideas for dedications, or anything like that, we'll be starting the process already, so.
I've already started jotting some stuff. I know it's coming, so.
Pictures, where was the highest snowbank? I mean, show pictures of the roof of the school, the snow all the way into the roof. I mean, I actually saw a roadside sign tonight. I don't think I've seen it all winter.
So does anybody have anything for Wayne?
I've already bothered him.
How are you doing, Wayne? Nice to see you.
You too?
Mm-hmm.
How's everything?
It's Augusta. That's about it.
I saw you up there the other day. You were a long ways off, and you were in a group, so I didn't.
Transportation.
I didn't interrupt you, but I was going to throw something at you, but I figured you're used to that, so right.
Going to get LePage to pay for all while you have it.
Speaking of transportation,
yes,
the state isn't planning on doing Bartlett Bridge and Lanigan Bridge the same time. I figured, you know.
No, I think Bartlett's going to be done this year.
16th.
Oh, it is 16th?
16th, yeah. Okay. It's advertised in February of 16 and for 16 construction.
When are they doing Lanigan?
Maybe
they
had
one at
the same time.
Which one?
No,
the one in Kennebunkport, from Kennebunk to Kennebunkport.
Oh, that's
yeah, that's Lanigan.
That's,
there's no date yet.
It's yeah, that's about the same time, because that's why they didn't want to do the detour.
I've already talked to the commissioner about that bridge. I says, you know, you got a million people that go across that bridge in the summertime. They're already looking at different ways to. They've got a thing called a slip bridge where they build the other bridge right beside it, and they come in and yank the old one out and slide the new one in. And there's a couple different things. I was up to DOT headquarters talking to the bridge guy and about that, just because it affects everybody down here, no matter what. So, because their original plan was put a temporary bridge to land it over behind Allison's. And I says your temporary bridge is going to cost more than your actual bridge you're replacing.
Yeah.
So they're looking at several different things down there, but it's just so much traffic goes across it in the summertime that, you know, they just, I just says you're not going to be able to close that the way you want it. So
there'll be some irate people who do that for you.
Yeah.
That'll hurt some businesses.
And I emailed DOT on, because Tom emailed me today about the light at Hill Road.
Yep.
And if Arundel was gonna have to pay for it or whatever. I always thought that any state road, they took care of it, but have they said that, oh, they have said?
Yeah, when they had the public hearing back here, that was one of the questions that I had, who pays for the light? And they said, the town does. And she said, you guys are requiring, you guys are fixing the road, why does the town have to? And I can't remember what the reasoning was at that point, and then Diane Robbins added on with a whole bunch of stuff. And I don't remember, but.
They installed the poles. They installed the poles and own the poles, but we pay for the lights and maintain them.
We do it down on Route One now?
Oh, you do the ones?
On Liver Road?
Yeah. That's what I was gonna ask, if you had to do that.
They do Campground Road, we do Liver Road.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Route One, both of them.
I mean, that doesn't make any sense. They should do all of them.
I will check.
Okay.
Interesting, on what basis they want to do that.
Good luck with that.
I know. Well, after your email, I kinda felt bad. I says, well, I've heard since for the last 15 years that we wanted to fix Hill Road and put a light there, and now that I've talked them into putting a light there. So, but I'll follow up.
Okay, thanks. Appreciate it.
Do you want me to go over anything on the budget or any, what we have now, or? Not even attempt to do so.
How much it's gonna cost us?
Nothing's passed, it's so far away from anything being done. What I told, I went to Lyman last Thursday and I was just left Dayton. If it passes the way it is right today, the way it was submitted, you're gonna receive revenue sharing this year the same as you did last year, which I think Arundel got $158,000 last year, and that's how it's set today. There's a lot of fight on revenue sharing, there's a lot of fight on the homestead, you know, on different things like that. If, like I said, if it stays the way it is, like on homestead, for seniors it doubles, but it's fully funded. Right now, all of homestead, the town's gonna cover half. So the town doesn't have to cover half anymore. So I mean, as far as town budget goes, you don't have to allocate or change your mill rate or however the town does that portion. But that was a fight right up front, because that's really a direct cost on property tax. The argument is that on the income tax side, and this is how the governor's selling it, is like, for example, Arundel's losing $158,000 this year on revenue sharing. When the tax cuts go into effect, the townspeople of Arundel are gonna save, I think it's like $1.1 million in income tax, about a 25% cut in income tax, going from 7.95 down to 5.75. So that's the justification on the changes. But I said at one of the meetings, I says, the problem is on the homestead side is you're directly changing property, that's a direct increase in property tax. And you said you didn't want to do that, so.
So,
you know, it's.
A loss of revenue,
right?
Me
right,
too.
Same thing.
Right.
Same thing.
Right. So, you know, I mean, it, so that's the justification, you know, for it, is the cut in income tax. Personally, myself, I've always thought if I would just soon not send any money to the state and send it all to the town, you know, so in this justification, if everything is average, is you send $1,000 or $1,100 to the state and we're not gonna get $150 back. So it's one of those things that, you know, philosophy-wise, you know, I've always said I'd rather pay no state income tax and I could pay almost double property tax. So it's more direct impact, and citizens can come and talk to you and have a lot more influence on budgets and what they want to do and what it would cost. But there's just a real big fight on all sides. I mean, the governor's getting a big pushback from Republicans because of, you know, the whole thing. I mean, the whole...
But you're not really Republican unless you...
Yeah, well, I guess I'm not, but I heard that.
Did you hear that this week?
After spending 2 hours explaining all the whole thing to Lyman, I was glad to hear that I wasn't a true Republican.
You have to figure out what you are wearing.
But the, you know, it's just, it's one of those things that I understand the reasonings, the overall goal. You want to try to attract more business if they're going to have it, you know, so income tax always comes in for business owners. So that's the thought process. If you can get the income tax down, then we're competitive with other states. By changing, by increasing the sales tax, you put more of a burden on tourists. So, and there's one thing that Velma's mentioned to me a whole bunch of times on meals and lodging, and he cut the meals tax. So that just made zero sense to me. I mean, it's a tax that, I don't want to talk for everybody, but nobody cares about the meals tax. It's a discretionary tax. You know, so, I mean, my first thought was you increase that one more and cut back, you know, on other ones.
Who's not going to come to the state of Maine with a pay the buck for a meal?
Yeah. Well, that's right, you know. And I mean, that's the argument, though, that I get all the time from Maine Tourism, is that we can't raise the meals and lodging because people won't come. And I said, do you not go to throughout the country? I mean, I think Las Vegas is, what, 18% or something like that, I think. And
I
Florida
know, I
is.
I
know, that's why I have a guard, right?
Nobody looks. Yeah. That's right. You know, so, I mean, that's one of those things that, I mean, I agree with the idea of shifting as much. We've done it on the turnpike. I mean, we changed on the turnpike when they changed the increase at New York last 2 years ago or 3 years ago. We've gone and changed the easy pass deduction system that the credits that Mainers get. We've gone from 53% out-of-state paying turnpike to 68%. So it's gone because of that increase of a dollar there, plus out-of-state people don't get the discount unless they buy a Maine Easy Pass separate. So, I mean, like for me, I put my pickup that I used to have a commercial account with on my personal plan because it ends up being free. Because I literally make the 50% discount every month. So by putting that on there, I automatically get the 50% discount. So it's literally my pickup's free on the turnpike. You know, so there's been a lot of benefits there, but that's the shifting, you know, to more of the out of state. And you're right, everybody's still going to come to Maine if it's 6%, 8%, or 10%.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, that was the first couple things was the meals when I saw the plan, and then was the homestead, and that changed because I kind of figuring out the in-betweens. And revenue sharing is always an issue, but it's been a problem for a long time that the towns have never known what they were going to get. And I mean, if we get a big enough income tax cut, people can pay an extra $100 or $200 to the town. You know, so it's just figuring out
from a philosophical standpoint, I mean, you reduce the income tax so that some people now are not going to pay for the services that they're going to want from their community. They don't have to anymore because they're not property tax owners. So only the property tax owners are not going to pay for those services.
And my concern, too, is the area. I mean, you take a coastal town who has million-dollar properties and businesses and everything, Booth Bay Harbor, you know, Bar Harbor, places like that.
Kennebunkport.
You know, our neighbors, yet at the same time, you take people up in Aroostook County who do not have this income. Their school systems, everything is very dependent on, you know, and the inequality, I think, is going to hit home. Just like, you know, I think New Hampshire has that with a lot of their school districts. And that's my concern, is you're taking something that can be shared a little bit more.
Yeah, but on schools, it's like you have, I mean,
they're not funding them.
The state pays 49 or 52 or whatever the number is right now. But the thing is, that's not 55% if they fully funded it of every town. You have towns like Kennebunkport, that doesn't get any. And then you have towns in Aroostook County that get 80 or 90%. So that's where that difference, you know, as far as schools goes.
But they need it.
No, absolutely. No, but absolutely. But I mean, so you, it's not like they're funding it the same, like we get, I think, what, 40% or something like that.
And I still think sales tax is going to hit the middle guy again, you know.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. But the middle income is going to save the money on income tax. The lower income people are going to get a sales tax credit. So for lower income people, they're going to get, as part of this plan, if it goes, like I said, this is all prefaced on what it is today, which it's always going to change maybe a lot. Because the problem is, too, is once you start changing too many of the other parts don't work.
That's right.
You know? So that's the big...
A lot of moving parts here.
Right. Oh, yeah. There's tons of moving parts. Yeah.
So if you have someone who is... They do own their own little piece of property. Maybe a small house. But they're low income enough that they actually maybe don't pay main income tax.
Yeah.
They don't pay an income tax, but you'd increase their sales tax. Are you still going to give them an income tax credit when they don't pay anything in the first place? Because their taxes are going to go up.
If their income is that low, what's going to happen too is the their standard deduction goes up in Maine. It's going to like double from where it is now.
Yeah.
So you're going to have more people that won't have to pay any income tax. But if they're that low, they're going to probably qualify for the property tax fairness credit, which is like the old circuit breaker, which that's going to go up. For under 65, that goes up to 1,000, which is 600 now. And for over 65, that goes up to 1,500, and it's 900 now for low income on property, for property owners. And over 65 gets 20,000 of homestead, which is fully funded, so the town doesn't have to cover the 5,000 that they have to now on everybody.
Well, that's so they still need to.
There's way too many moving parts on how it's all gonna. But as like I said, if it passes this year, as far as of revenue sharing, it's set so that you'll get what you got last year. So. It may all blow up, and then who knows what it's going to end up being.
Wayne, what's he going to do with second homes? People have camps and stuff like that. Is he planning on doing anything there?
Well, they wouldn't qualify for any of the
Is he going to put on a special tax because someone owns shorefront property or a second property?
I don't know if it wouldn't be an additional because they would already pay the regular mill rate of property tax.
I read something where he wanted to do something that people had second homes or something. No?
Yeah, I haven't seen that done. I mean, the big...
I don't know how they do that.
The big tax break things, too, though, is like all military pensions are non-taxable. And there's a phase-in on regular pensions up to $35,000 for seniors. And that's over a five-year and has something to do with some federal law that they can't do it right away.
How old's the governor? Is he taking care of himself?
No, no.
But if he needs an ambulance, our rate's the same.
If he's paying, we'll triple our rate.
No. We rose our rate. Can I turn the camera off there?
Need a motion to adjourn. Motion to adjourn. And a second? Second is at 7:56 p.m. All those in favor? Motion carries.
Thank you.